it is my pleasure to introduce CA Chaitanya. CA Chaitanya is a director and an operating committee member of D.E.Shah India Pvt. Ltd. He hails from Hyderabad, is a qualified chartered accountant, has worked at D.E.Shah India for over 6 years and has over 18 years of total experience. He oversees the finance and admin functions for the D.E.Shah entities in India and financial operation teams, a finance group specializing in analytics, reporting, tax and compliance. Prior to D.E.Shah India, he has worked with leading MNCs like Microsoft, UBS and GE. D.E.Shah India corporate governance resides within the operating committee, which is composed of 4 directors. As a member of the operating committee group, CA Chaitanya is responsible for firm governance, policies and administration. I hereby present CA Chaitanya to the lively audience.
All right, good morning, everyone. All right, that's a pretty nice, warm, enthusiastic good morning. All right, so let's just give it a minute for the presentation to be up.
By the time the presentation starts, friends, the sessions today, first on employment, then on practice, I think this would be the two most important sessions. And my entire passion, my entire work, making 70 volunteers work for this prestigious conference tomorrow, is basically on these two sessions, one on employment, one on practice. Look, it's very difficult choice. Believe me, we pass CA and then we feel that you don't know what is to be done. Most of the time we find we are not aware. We are only seeing it from outside, what employment is. You have seen the employees driving cars. You have seen the employee flying to various countries, but you have not seen them working hard, sacrificing their personal life, and there are so many other things. Plus, most of us have that ego that being, once we are a chartered accountant, we know everything, we are great. And that attitude sometimes is causing us harm. So that's why we have today two people who are virtually aware of what the finance professionals like us are little bit of lacking, which is not getting us proper placements in a proper MNC companies. Please, your selfies can wait, your WhatsApps can wait, your friendly discussions can stop for some time. As if you are listening to a class which is for exam tomorrow, please be very attentive and listen to these things, okay? I think, is there any problem with the AV? You're okay? Just play it, not a problem. Thank you.
All right, once again, good morning. Thank you. So, firstly, it gives me an immense pleasure to be on the stage today and address some of the best minds in the industry and some of the best professionals in the making. So I take this opportunity also to thank the Institute for giving me this chance to address all of you, share my thoughts, and walk you through the journey that I've been through over the last few years. So Pankaj and I keep walking into each other so often, and Pankaj is such a passionate person who's always looking to give back to the give back to the institute. And each time we meet, one of the most common topic that we discuss about is the quality of the CAs that we produce, the career paths that the CAs choose, and what is it that we can do to enhance, and how can we as an industry collaborate with the institute to make sure that the crop of CAs, all of you, when you graduate, when you qualify, how can we make all of you more employable? How can we ensure that the brand CA stands out compared to all the competition that we have? So there's a lot of discussion that Pankaj and I used to have, and I'm glad that I have a chance to actually address all of you today and be able to share my thoughts. I would say that with a little gray hair on my head, you know, first you've made a great decision in choosing to pursue a CA. So it's one of the most important decisions that you've made. And now that you've made that decision, you know, you've got to be proud that you're pursuing it, and you'll see through it and qualify and become a proud CA professional. You know, when I look at all my peers in the industry, there's a lot of respect that the CA profession has. People look up to us. People look up to us for guidance, for counsel, and for a lot of advice. And not just once, but day in and day out. Because we're supposed to be the experts. We're supposed to be the best the most appropriate advice that we could give to anyone who wants that. And while I don't know where the CA profession today ranks in the marriage market, it's been a really long time that I've got married, but I must tell you that it definitely has a big cutting edge in the corporate world. It's something that I'm very proud of, being a CA myself, and each one of you should be proud of that you're pursuing the course and you would very soon be a qualified CA. Having said that, what do I want to do today? When Pankaj approached me and to talk to you about the do's and don'ts of employment in MNCs, I went back. It was walking down the memory lane for me when I was 2 decades ago, sitting probably in an auditorium like this. Of course, honestly, we didn't have such nice sessions back then, but I was one among you. I was a CA student 2 decades ago, trying to figure out how do I study accounting, auditing, tax, costing, and what have you. And so I went back, jogged my memory, and looked at what was my journey. So I want to share with you what that journey has been, what my learnings have been, and what do I do when I look to hire fresh chartered accountants, or what do I look for when I want to assess my team. So that's broadly what I will cover over the next 25 odd minutes, right? One thing that pretty much hardwired in all of us, I think, when we become a CA, is we always have a disclaimer on everything. So in line with that, because it's hardwired into me as well, I'd like to offer a disclaimer that whatever I share today are really my thoughts. Those are my personal thoughts based on my journey and my experiences. So it's got nothing to do with the views of either my current or any of my prior employers. Right? So having said that, it's taken me a lot of years to learn the few things that I've learned. So what I'll try to do today is give you a flavor of what it takes to be successful in an MNC. What should you look for when you work for an MNC, and what my personal learnings are. So firstly, why an MNC? And again, I'm not trying to say that MNC is the only job. There are many jobs outside. You could get into practice, you could work for a startup, you could work for, you could set up your own company, you could work for an Indian company, but it's just that it's sharing my experiences through working with organizations like GE, UBS, Microsoft, and currently D.E.Shah, right? So firstly, what does an MNC give you? I think the first one is about global context. So anything that, you know, an MNC does not necessarily mean that it's a foreign company. It could be an Indian company, which has a footprint in many countries. So it gives you a global context. Anything that they do, they've got to think not just about how it impacts in India or in the single location, but how do they be able to do the same thing across many locations. So it's really about thinking global, but acting local in each and every location that you operate in. Early in my career with GE, I got an opportunity to work on Sarbanes-Oxley. That was in 2003. When Sarbanes-Oxley was mandatory from 2004, GE wanted to pilot it a year ahead and be prepared. So I was working for GE in the SOX team, implementing or trying to do a pilot across 50 countries where GE Capital was operating. They were operating in about 100 plus countries, but the pilot was for 50 countries. So it's just to give you, that's the sheer scale of what an organization would operate in, and the opportunity that you get to connect with people, understand what the nuances are for each location, how you've got to customize a global implemented project for each location, and be able to actually roll out on one standard date, one go live date across the globe or across all of these organizations. So that's really the scale that an MNC typically gives you. The second one is about diversity and the multi-geography stakeholders that you get to work with. So, you know, while a company in India would want to hire the best people, like all of you in this room, you know, they want to do the same thing with people across all the countries that they work in. So when I work with my peers in the other countries, I get to work with CPAs who've done the CPA from Australia or from UK or from elsewhere. I get to work with MBAs from the premier colleges or premier universities like a Harvard or Wharton, or scientists from Stanford. So it's just the sheer opportunity of working with the best minds, not just in one location, but across the globe. And it's that amalgamation of those minds that really gives you a lot of thinking opportunities, a lot of learning opportunities by connecting with them, by understanding what their thoughts are, what their mindset is, and how they go about doing things, right? And also want to talk about global mobility. So one of the biggest advantages that I've seen working in an MNC is the opportunities that you get not just to work in one location, but many locations. In fact, because the organization want to cross-pollinate talent, you know, if they find someone who's doing extremely well in India, you know, they want to use that talent not just in India, but across many other locations. So they encourage a lot of mobility. That also gives people a lot of growth. If you've done a role in India, you want to do a role in APAC, or you want to do a role in Middle East, and then maybe Europe and Asia, and then maybe at some point across the globe. So it's just that it opens up doors for bright, talented, accomplished individuals to explore many opportunities. So it also helps people not hit a glass ceiling. You know, there's only so much that you can grow in a multinational which is headquartered elsewhere if you were to operate in one location. So it gives you a chance to work in the headquarters, in a regional place, or in any one country as well. So again, I think in this context, finance is very uniquely positioned. If I look at a sales, you really need a lot of local knowledge. You want to do HR. HR needs a lot of local language, a local connect, understanding a lot of culture to be able to do a HR role. However, finance, if you were, let's say, doing a sales finance, or you were doing analytics, or you were doing sales strategy, you know, it's not limited to a location. It's probably the most portable talent across the globe. So if what you do in India, there's no question why you cannot do the same thing elsewhere in the world. So that way, it's probably you're in a profession, we are in a profession that's really most portable and have the most opportunities across the globe, right? So the next one that I want to share with you is about the learning opportunities that an MNC provides. You know, what an MNC tries to do normally is have homogeneous set of people. So the kind of trainings that they have, the kind of learning opportunities that they do, the kind of drill that they put you through so that a manager in India, a manager in Australia, a manager in Singapore, or a head of sales in one location tries to think the same way across. So you get a lot of standardized practices, standardized learning opportunities. And also a large organization, again, if I were to refer back and give you an example from my career with GE, I got an opportunity to work with GE Lighting in a factory in Gujarat. You know, I was doing ERP implementation there. And then next, I worked with a GBHEL collaboration. That was a joint venture. It gave me a perspective about how to work with an Indian PSU and amalgamate a mindset of a multinational with the talent or the domain knowledge of an Indian PSU. It gave me an opportunity to work with GE Capital at their headquarters in the US. And then I did GE Infrastructure, which was you know, sensors and the lifts and fire safety equipment. So it gives you a wide breadth of exposure. It gives you exposure to different business cycles, different business environments. The leaders in GE Capital think very differently from a manufacturing industry. So it just gives you that exposure of how do you react, how do you think, how do you address, adapt to various business requirements, various challenges that each of the business faces, and what are your strategies to address your customer needs or your business needs. So I think it's just the sheer amount of learning opportunities that an MNC provides that some of the advantages of working in an MNC are, right? Now, having said that, now if I were to look at what in my view is long-term success, and while it's taken me years to learn this, I've tried to summarize as much as I can in one slide here. Again, if for me, this is my mantra. It does not necessarily mean that this is the only mantra, this is the only Bible of success, right? This is what has worked for me. This is what I've learned through my own failures. This is what I've learned through people who've coached me, people who've mentored me, people who've told me what do I need to do to be successful in my career, right? So it's a triage. I look at it as a triangle. It's a spectrum of skills that one needs to have. The first one I call it is the what. So this is about doing the job. So really this is about getting your role done. This is what you've primarily been hired for. This is your core competence. So if you look at what all goes into this, this is about, do you know your accounting standards well? You know, do you know your taxation well? Do you know how to interpret the tax laws across various businesses? You know, tax laws are not always black and white. How good are you at understanding your business challenges and adapting, you know, your knowledge to be able to advise and counsel the business? It's about, you know, how do you use your knowledge to drive process improvements? How do you use your knowledge to be innovative? How do you use your talent to pick up stretch goals? Which is, are you just doing what you're given, what your core job description is, or are you going above and beyond? Do you have the fire in your belly to take on more, to be inquisitive, to be always wanting to learn more and do more? So in some way, this really boils down to how well do you do your job, how well do you know your subject, how well do you how well people respect you for your talent, and are you the go-to person on a particular subject, and how accomplished are you in doing each task that you take? So what does this do when you build this kind of skill set? You really become the most dependable resource for your organization or for your manager or for your team. And by being the most dependable resource, it makes you in some way very indispensable, because the organization needs you. You are the best talent that is available. You are the go-to person for everything. So it kind of makes you probably the best in your team in delivering the work, in completing the task. But do you think this is enough? Is this adequate? Is this going to get you places, and is this going to make you give you the next role, make you a leader? In my view, this is only a part of what your personality is. The next one that I've learned, which no one teaches you, there's no textbook that teaches you how to do a job. It's about how your experiences are, how do you learn, how open you are, how inquisitive, what's on your radar, how do you imbibe, how do you adapt to situations, how do you address each person, or how do you address each situation which is different from today. So each challenge is very, each challenge or each task that you take, each set of people that you work with is very different from one to the other. So it's all really boils down to your situational leadership. So when I talk about how, it really comprises your personality. It is the softer aspect. It is about how do you respect people? What are your interpersonal skills? How do you collaborate with people? Because you're not an individual that works in an organization. You've got to work with a lot of other teams. You work with senior leaders. You work with cross-geographical teams. So what is your skill set on being able to influence, on being able to impact? How do you create the impact? Just by having the best knowledge in accounting standards, you're not going to be able to push through your agenda unless you have great soft skills. So what you also need to develop, and what I've in my last 20 years very consciously developed, not through a textbook, not necessarily through a classroom learning, but through experiences, through observing people, by budding up with people, by job shadowing and working closely with people by seeking help through a mentor or through a coach, really learned these set of skills. In my mind, this is what really differentiates a person. Everyone can be great at the what. You know, you can learn. It's very easy for you to spend extra hours, burn midnight oil in the office, and accomplish the tasks. However, it is these set of skills that you've got to develop that differentiate one to the other. And, okay, so having done that, do you think that both of these are going to get you everywhere? I think both of these will make you a very accomplished resource. They'll ensure that each time you're hitting it out of the park. But I think in my mind, what really is the home run is the third bet, or which is proven capability. That is, what I mean when I say proven capability is to do both of these in a very sustained way. To do it every time. To do it in a way that you become very predictable. So if I were to say, I will give a task to X, I know that Mr. X or Miss X is dependable. They're not going to damage relationships with the people that they work with. And they're going to do it consistently and accomplish that each and every time. So for me, in some sense, if I have to summarize, this is the triage of what differentiates one to the other. So there are 1,000 people here in this room. So do you think all the 1,000 are going to be the same when you get into a job or when you start out in a corporate world or do everything? No, you're not going to be. Today, all the students that I've grown up with, we're not the same. We have varied levels of skill sets on this chat. Someone's great at accounting, someone's great at collaboration, someone's great at creating that impact or working with people. So as you add each of these skills or behaviors, what you see on the left side of the chart are your skills. What you see on the right are behaviors. And it's that amalgamation of the skills and behaviors and doing it and having them in abundance, having them always, and using them always is really what drives the differentiation from one to the other. Why do you feel that one of your peers is more successful than you? It's because they probably have one skill set in this page or maybe something that is not even on this page which you don't have or which I don't have. So it's really about what else can you build on? What else can you add to your armor that's going to continue to differentiate, that's going to continue to give you the edge than in relative terms and make you a better individual, make you a better leader as you progress in your corporate career? Right. So for me, this is what I've learned. This is what I practice. This is what I always keep in my mind. Right. And next, if I were to kind of summarize do's and don'ts, I wouldn't really call it as do's and don'ts, because there's nothing like do's and don'ts which is in standard or etched in stone. It's very situational. What you do today may be a don't tomorrow. So it's we got to continue to adapt based on what the situation is. And like they say, it's always different strokes for different folks. There's no one standard way of approaching. There's no one standard way of doing or reacting or addressing a situation. So I put down a list of what's worked for me. So if I were to talk quickly through this, the first one is really about having clarity of thought, which means even simple things. What do you want to have for lunch today? You know, do you have the clarity or do you mull over it? Or where do you want to go for a holiday? You know, do you keep mulling over it, or do you have that sense of clarity in mind? You know, and if I were to look at it from your context, you know, you're at a stage where the many opportunities that you have. You know, so it's very important for you to have that clarity. Do you want to practice? Do you want to get into profession? If you want to get into profession, what do you want to do? Do you want to build or do you want to be a specialist in accounting? Or do you want to explore tax? Or do you want to do any specialized roles, like let's say equity research or valuation or pricing? So I think it's very critical for us to have that clarity of thought on what do we want to do, because each action that you take, each work that you do should always try to get you closer to that target, should always get you closer to what you really want to do. So it's important to break that down into what your near-term or what your long-term goals are. So you kind of break that down into small milestones. What do I want to do this quarter or this month? What each task helps you get eventually to your goals or your objectives? You know, that's what I do at beginning of each year, try to figure out what do I want to do this year, which is either could be the same as last year or different from last year, and break that down into smaller milestones that I can measure, that I can track, and continue to keep me honest and conscious of whether I'm in the right direction or not. So the second one is about having strong fundamentals. You know, as CAs, I think one of the things that people look up to us is for the knowledge that we carry. And that means we are expected to be the experts, the go-to people on our subject. You know, and this is something that I wanted to share, which, and when we observe the fresh crop of CAs that we graduate off late, and we go to campuses to interview, we do a lot of interviews with fresh chartered accountants, I think this is an area where we can definitely do a lot better. And that's something that I would urge each one of you. What you're going to be judged the day you graduate, the day you wear the CA badge, is not, it's accomplished. You are a qualified CA, it's done deal. You know, your Act 1 is done. Your Act 2, that's just the entry ticket into the world. So what you've got to do then, it really matters. And when we look at people and talk to them about subject, at times there's a big gap that exists. And if I were to give you a couple of examples, the people who tell us that depreciation is a cash expense, or there have been interviews where folks share with us that we pay deferred tax along with advanced tax, or some of the basic things like, do you know what a T account is? Can you pass a journal entry? What's a journal entry for depreciation? Or what's a journal entry for sales returns? Or, you know, how do you, what's deferred tax? Can you give us examples of deferred tax beyond depreciation or beyond gratuity? Can you give us a little more insights which are practical in nature? You know, that's where we see a lot of people failing. So what you are going to be recognized for when you graduate is not your qualification, not that sheet of paper which you carry that claims to you to be a CA, but it's what's in your brain. It's what you've done during those 3 years of articles. So one thing I would also urge is something very, very unique to our profession is the unique combination of theory, which is all the exams that we pass through, and the articleship that we go through, which is invaluable, which is something that is irreplaceable when you get down to doing your first job. You do your articles well, trust me, it prepares you for your job on day one. That makes a huge difference. For all of you who are probably not doing your articles full time, it definitely is going to make a big difference against people who do their articles full time. They're going to have an edge over you from day one. Excuse me. So it boils down to what your technical knowledge is. How good are you on the subject? So please do not ignore that. That's what's going to cut the mark. That's what's going to get you through the gate when you start looking out for a job. The next one I want to talk to you about is one of the most unproductive time that all managers spend on, including me, is on follow-up. Following up with people on tasks. So whatever tasks that you have, you know, it's you are the owner of those tasks. Take that ownership. Take that, be independent, so that no one else has to follow through or follow up with you, set a reminder, and keep checking whether you are on track or whether you're finishing it. If someone's given you a task, or you've taken a responsibility, it's for each one of us to feel that accountability and ensure that, you know, we own it completely, we deliver it to the quality and on the timelines that we've accepted or that we've agreed to or we've committed to. The next one is, again, very close to my heart, something that I observe in young heels, is people who chase titles. You know, a lot of people want to move from an analyst to a senior analyst, to a manager, to a senior manager. And trust me, title means nothing. Title in one organization to another organization is very different. What a manager is in one organization could be a vice president or a senior vice president in another organization. It really doesn't mean anything beyond an ego boost to yourself. What matters is what is the role that you're doing, what is the job, what's the content of your role, what difference are you making, what impact are you creating, and what's your influence. Really, so what do I tell people who are young in the career is to really seek opportunities, you know, seek roles. If you, and going back to connecting this with the clarity of thought, if you want to be a CFO, talk to a CFO. What does a CFO, what did he or she do to be able to get there? You know, what are the skill sets they've built? You know, they probably did controllership as a role. They probably did FP&A, which is analytics as their role. They probably did a global role, you know, that gives them a perspective of not just in one location, but multi-location. You know, they probably also did a cross-functional role, which is non-finance. They probably worked with someone who's very senior in a strategy role. So, you know, chase roles, chase skill sets. Try to pick your next role that's going to give you something that'll take you to your eventual destination. So if you want to be a tax professional, what do you want to do? Do you want to be an expert on indirect tax or direct tax or both? So each role that you do, try to figure out what's going to take you there. You know, maybe international tax, indirect tax, there is GST, there is customs. You know, how do you build such that you are getting that domain expertise, getting your hands dirty on each of these roles to build that expertise and eventually get down to the target that you have? So please always chase roles, chase skill sets, and not the titles, right? Then the last one that I want to talk about here is each time that you do something, give it your 100%. Or, you know, something that's very common, especially at this time of the year, which is the beginning of a new year, is the new year resolutions. Most of you must have had that in the past. Most of us have it now. One of the common, most common new year resolution is to be fit and lose weight. And if you go back and see how many actually accomplish, it's probably a very minuscule of it. And why do you think that happens? It's because no one does that every time and each time. It's about giving it your 100%. Again, if you think about what does it take for water to boil, water boils at 100 degrees Celsius on normal room, normal atmospheric pressure. What happens if each time water boils to 98 degrees, 99 degrees, or 90 or 50 degrees? It's not going to boil. If you want the water to boil, it has to be 100 or more than 100 each and every time. So if you want to do something, you got to do it 100% every time. And that's what's going to make a difference. And especially in this era where there's so much social media intervention and there's such overlap between our social personal priorities with our professional priorities, it's very compelling for us to be checking, be it a Facebook or a WhatsApp or Instagram or what have you, or take a selfie at various locations. Trust me, do that. I'm not saying don't do that. When you do that 100%. But if you're working, do that 100% too. So try and do whatever you're doing to the best. And do that each time and every time. And that's what's going to make a difference. Right? And I didn't want to put together a list of don'ts, but what I also want to leave you with is what my learnings are. Again, what I've learned through my career is I can't accomplish everything all by myself. You know, for me, the pillar of support is really my team, my peers, my managers, and everyone else that I work with, that I collaborate with. So it's always team over self. You know, like one of my favorite sports person, Michael Jordan, says, talent can win you matches, but it's always teamwork that's going to win you the championship. So there's nothing more important. And every time that I look at my own team, assess people, or when I look at myself, if someone's great at their work, they may be the best, but if they can't work well with in a team, if they don't respect others, if they don't collaborate with others, they're not going to move up the ladder. You know, the collective output of working together and working as a team is always exponentially large than working individually. So that's critical and something that all of us need to continuously be aware of. And the next one is about being prepared. Whatever it is, it could be a small meeting, it could be a discussion, it could be even a conversation in a walkway. Be prepared. You know, one very early on in my career, someone told me that treat every conversation that you're having as an interview. You know, that could be I'm talking to my peer, I'm talking to someone else. Even if I run into someone in an elevator and if I have to give an elevator speech about something, it's always about being prepared, always about being conscious, always about thinking through before you talk about what is it that you've got to say. So again, for me, that's worked well when I'm conscious about it. Right, and the next one is about career. So who manages our careers? Do you think your manager is going to manage your career? Or did my manager manage my career? I have a lot of people who come by and ask, what should I do next in my career? I've done this role, I've closed books for 2 years, I've filed income tax returns, I've worked with the auditors, I've got a qualification fee audit report. What next? You know, honestly, my answer always is, I don't know. You know, what next is not for me to figure out, it's not for me to advise, it's for you to figure out what challenges you, what motivates you, you know, what drives you, what keeps you happy, you know, what are those roles, what is the kind of work that you want to do. So each time you want to figure out, go back, think, don't depend on anyone else. I always think through what next do I want to do, and I go back and seek help. So your managers will help you get to where you want to get you, but they're not the ones who are going to figure out or decide for you what your next role should be. That's for each one of us to decide and make up our mind and pursue our careers, right? The next one that's worked for me is to have a mentor. A mentor is probably the most inexpensive, almost free sounding board that you have. A mentor is someone who's unconditionally interested in your career or in your well-being. So you kind of bounce off ideas with them. You kind of seek their advice, their counsel on, that could be on any individual task, that could be on your career, that could be on your personal life. So they're really someone that you look up to, that someone who can guide you through situations or through your life. So having a mentor has always helped me, you know, when I have a conflict of choices, when I have a conflict of decisions, you know, it helps me balance or weigh the pros and cons, bounce that off with someone, and drive towards the right decision. Right. The last one that I want to talk about is something which is probably more critical than everything else that I've spoken about, which is your health. What I've seen is people who are bright, people who are great, people who accomplish, have typically neglect health, and I don't know why. And I've seen that in most of the teens, I've seen that in the young 20s. I have my own team members, I have people in my own organization or other organizations who do well, but they kind of fall ill quite often. You know, I don't know whether it's the food, whether it's the air, or what's wrong in where we are, that and what's happening to our immune system. But if you do not take care of your health, if I don't take care of my health, immaterial of how good we are and everything else, it's not going to take us anywhere. So I'd like to close saying that really health is wealth, and if you take care of that, all of the others is something that you can work on. You can spend 1 year, you can spend 3 years, you can spend 5 years, but you can get there. But if you don't take care of your health, you're not going to have the opportunity to build that skill set or seek those opportunities and build a great career and build a big leader, right? So that's what I wanted to share through my experiences and learnings. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity. If there are any questions, I'm happy to take questions. All right, sure. Thank you so much once again. Thanks, Pankaj. Thanks to the Institute.